This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. Welcome to Dreamland, and I'd like to welcome Preston Dennett back to the show. Preston's been with us a number of times. I consider him to be one of the leading UFO investigators in the world. Preston works quietly, I would say. He is an excellent interviewer. I actually know some witnesses that Preston has interviewed, so I can tell you from their standpoint, he's very good at what he does. And he's been doing this for a long time. Preston, how long have you been active in this?
Oh, I was just looking back on that. It's most of my life. I'm now approaching 35 years in this field. So just about. It's a long time.
Same here. Now, you learned about your family having encounters back in the 80s. Is that correct?
Yep. My brother, my sister-in-law, my other sister-in-law, three, four, five family friends. Stupidly, I brought it up at work. You know, I've been in the same office for 35 years now.
Yeah.
And many of them have had encounters too, and not small ones. I mean, missing time, gray aliens. This is not uncommon, I guess. I mean, I think a lot of people are having these experiences.
Yeah, well, I believe so. And now that in the situation we're in now, when the government is still equivocal about it, but I think it's been admitted that there is something going on, at least in the skies. And I'm wondering what your opinion is about whether or not they'll continue to deny or skate around the contact part of it or not.
Yeah, of course they will. I think, you know, we have had great recent steps towards disclosure, with the Pentagon saying flat out, this was a couple of years ago, we have material from otherworldly vehicles.
Yeah.
I mean, that my jaw hit the floor when I heard that. I couldn't believe it wasn't front page news. Now it is, but there's still a cover up. I mean, let's face it. They know what this is. They've known for over 70 years, and all this mealy-mouthed hand-wringing is disingenuous. I mean, they know. So
that's right. And they must know. You know, I think that, well, for example, there have to be FBI files about abductions. There have to be, because people must have reported this as a crime. I almost reported this. In fact, I did report. I reported to the New York State Criminal Investigation Division at first, and they even came out to my cabin, but there was no evidence. That couldn't do anything. But those reports are on record somewhere. And not necessarily the New York CID report of a, you know, travel to a witness who, you know, who said I was very coy about it. I didn't say what I thought happened. As I recall, I was still not sure what had happened. And I described the lights and stuff I'd seen and the sense of being kidnapped and so forth. But the guy couldn't find any evidence and he just left. But the FBI has got to have more substantial cases, but they weren't even asked for this by the Senate committees. They were asked for stuff about UFOs, not stuff about people.
Yeah, I mean, I know many contactees who are being surveilled by apparent government officials. They know about this. I know people who've had their hypnosis tapes stolen. They've had break-ins where they wrote down exactly what happened.
I've had break-ins too. And I have a piece of that material that you referred to earlier. And it's already been authenticated. Another part of it has been authenticated of the same piece. So it's well hidden. because I know they might break in here. I would have had more, but I had them I had them analyzed at Southwest Research in Texas, and they were quote unquote lost. So yeah, that does happen. And do you think that it might get more intense now that we're in a situation where basically the world knows that there's something flying around in the skies, but so far the media and the, especially not the official world, have been willing to take us close encounter witnesses on? They haven't been willing to do that.
Yeah, I think it's going to get more intense. I mean, this is a can of worms in the truest sense. And at some point, I think the government's hand is being forced. I don't think this is something they want to do. I think there's a lot of foot dragging, a lot of backpedaling, probably panic within the cover-up itself, with some people wanting to disclose. It's clearly tightly controlled.
Yes.
We can see that. I can't imagine this going the other direction. This phenomena seems to be slowly accelerating, or perhaps yes, even more quickly. I think from the ET angle, they're pushing towards disclosure. It looks to me like they're conducting a vigorous publicity campaign.
That's an interesting way of putting it. Can you expand on that?
Yeah, I've been looking at this for a while because, you know, generally speaking, this is an evasive phenomena. They come at night. You know, they're not flying around in the skies in large numbers during the day. You can't just go outside and see a UFO at any given time. But on the other hand, there's this sort of other type of UFO behavior, which UFO researchers call a display. And we see this over and over again. Phoenix Lights, the Hudson Valley Wave, Gulf Breeze, Wytheville, Virginia, the Topanga Canyon Wave, Belgium, a huge wave in France in the 1950s. Over and over again, they are showing themselves to sometimes groups of people, sometimes it's individually. But I started to really wonder about this when I discovered the schoolyard encounter cases. You know, the Rua Zimbabwe case. That's not unique. This is something that's happening all over the world. They're hovering over schools, showing themselves to 40, 50 students at a time, 100, 200, teachers too. And I started looking at other cases like that. I found a drive-in theater encounter where a UFO hovered over a drive-in theater and showed itself to 200 people and thought it was unique. It's not. It's another subject. I mean, I wrote a whole book about this. I found more than 100 cases where they will come right down over a drive-in theater and show themselves off to a group of people. It's deliberate showing off. So, I think they're definitely announcing their presence in sort of a quiet way without trying to cause too many waves.
I think that, you know, my wife used to call it the theater in the sky because they're obviously showing themselves off and clearly. So why are they doing that? Why is it this way? You have, I guess one of the reasons might be that they want to get through to people. You know, they were in my life, all my life, essentially. And they were in particular from the summer before the communion experience, which was in December of 85, that summer, we were living at our cabin, and I began having unbelievable migraine headaches every day. And what I didn't know at the time was that these headaches were my mind rejecting this presence that was there. At the same time, I became incredibly frightened. And I bought an alarm system and put it in and bought a big shotgun and used to patrol around the house at night. And my wife was going crazy. What are you, nuts? You're out here in the woods. You're finally in a place which is the area had no crime rate. There was no crime. So here I am, living in Greenwich Village, which had a pretty high crime rate in those days. Then I go out into the woods, and what do in the woods? I'm waiting for burglars. But it wasn't burglars.
Yeah, I hear this all the time.
Yeah.
I talked to another guy who was wondering if he was a contactee, and he's like, you know, we have five locks on our doors. Like, five? You know, why? What? He says, I have a fear of intruders. His whole right. family did.
Bud called his book Intruders for a reason.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a sense of intrusion about this that's very powerful.
Yes, yeah, I think, I mean, people will sleep with night lights on, can't sleep in the dark. There's definitely a real scary aspect to this, particularly in the beginning for people.
Well, that's true for me. I mean, I have contacts all the time now. I have a surveillance system in the house. You know how I know I've had a contact? Because it turns itself off automatically during the contact. I mean, they do it. So you'll have the thing working and you can see me sleeping in the bed or out in the living room meditating or something. And then suddenly it's blank for 15 minutes. And then it turns itself back on again. And guess what? They turned it off because they were there.
Yeah,
incredibly frustrating, of course, because I'd like to get something that proved it finally for me, but so far no cigar.
Yeah, people will set up video cameras, and then they get up to go to the bathroom. Boom, that's when it happens.
Right.
So
exactly.
I mean, they know.
Really good at keeping themselves hidden. And why do you think that is?
You know, I can only speculate that they're not quite ready for full-on disclosure. For announcing their presence in a way that is undeniable. But I feel like we're moving towards it. I think this is why they're conducting a vigorous publicity campaign. So I'm like, why? Is it just announcing their presence? Why do they want people to know about them? I think ultimately their end game is to make open official contact. And there are several things that are stopping this. You know, it's our slow spiritual growth, we're not able to deal with their presence in an open way. Our governments are not truthful, transparent, or forthcoming. I think if disclosure actually ramps up and goes all the way, we will have open official contact.
Talk about the spiritual, what you referred to as slow spiritual growth, because we're generally very interested in that on this show. This has got a lot to do with spiritual growth. There's no question about that.
Sure does. And this is a pattern I've noticed. There are several patterns as to who's being contacted and why. It's evenly divided between men and women pretty much perfectly. I noticed that early on. And it's certainly doesn't have anything to do with race or education or political affiliations or blood type even. I think it's very much across the board. All kinds of people are being contacted. But one pattern I've certainly noticed is that people who are having contact are profoundly psychic. These are people who have a wide variety of paranormal events. And sometimes this seems to be perhaps before contact. Sometimes it's a result of contact. But at any rate, when someone is having extensive encounters, they experience a profound spiritual awakening, and it's not unusual for contactees to develop psychic abilities. They're precognitive, they're clairvoyant, they start having astral travel. That certainly happened with me. I was looking back at it. When I started having out-of-body experiences was right when I learned UFOs were real. Same month, practically. So
fascinating.
Yeah, I just kind of made that connection. This is a huge part of the contact phenomena. This is one of their main agendas. They've got multiple agendas, the hybrid baby agenda, certainly, trying to wake people up to the dangers of nuclear proliferation and destroying the environment. But spirituality is a huge part of this. They are doing their best to wake people up. In fact, I've had witnesses told by the ETs, this is our gift to you for what we have taken from you. We have woken you up.
That's very much my own personal experience, but what have they taken from us?
I think people have agreed, many of them, to be a part of this phenomena. On some level, they've agreed. Whether this is something that they have consciously agreed to or not, I think that's a matter of some debate because we have our consciousness is compartmentalized. Many people go to bed at night and don't remember anything. We have this huge part of our mind that is not available to a lot of people. And I think they're trying to wake us up to that. And then on some level, we do agree to this. Certainly the hybrid baby phenomena is something I think is one of the hardest issues to deal with for contactees.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And I think that's what they're taking from us, our genetic material. That's our gift to them. And their gift to us is a huge boost in our spiritual growth. And those are direct quotes from the ETs. We have given you a huge boost in your spiritual growth. I've heard that in so many words over and over again.
It's an interesting issue, and I have to wonder exactly what it means. Now, when we come back, we're going to take a brief break for our free Dreamlanders so they can enjoy some commercials, which they do enjoy, or they would be subscribers. And when we get back, we're going to talk a little bit about what that gift entails and what has been taken from us. And then we're going to get into Wondrous, Preston's new book, which is indeed Wondrous, 25 True UFO Encounters. It's really one of the best books of encounter descriptions I've ever read. And by a master researcher like Preston, it's impressive, very impressive.
Did we misunderstand the teaching of Jesus? Perhaps a long time ago, perhaps almost as soon as he rose from the dead, we mistook him for something that he may not have been. But we do know one thing, he was one of us. His life and his resurrection reveal the power of the good in all of us. And his teaching shows anybody, whether they have religious beliefs or not, how to find that goodness and live it. Get Jesus a New Vision. It's available as an audio book. It is available as a paperback and as a Kindle. Get it today.
When you start to ask the question, it unfolds. The fabric of space itself, how it's made, what is it made of?
We're not alone in this universe. We never have been.
Alien intelligences have cohabited with us on this planet for millions of years.
We inherited the obsession from the Anunnaki.
Anyone that still thinks that we're the ones that are obsessed with gold does not know enough about the true history of our species, how we came to be here,
and the conditions that brought us here.
We are not unique in this universe. Extraterrestrials do exist. We are, so to say, the copies of them.
We'll be right back. We're talking to Preston Dennett. His new book, Wondrous, 25 True UFO Encounters. Preston, what do you have a sense of what they are taking? And we're going to talk about the babies in a few minutes, but just because I do feel in my own experience that there's something connected with memories or parts of my life that have sort of been removed, I would say. Like, I was noticing the other day, I have a really marvelous memory. I've been blessed with a very good memory. And I happened to look at an old TV show, some mystery show that I had watched years ago, and I didn't remember it. Normally, I would remember every detail, as I can never watch anything twice or read a book twice, unfortunately, for this reason. But I didn't remember it hardly at all. And I thought to myself, I thought back onto that period of time, and I don't really remember my life much from then. You know, John Lear used to say that they were soul eaters, that they took souls. Do they take something else from us? Are we like, do they harvest something from us, like our memories and our the joy of life, do you think?
I'm not sure that I would put it in quite those words, but I do think what they are taking is our experience and sort of sharing it perhaps vicariously. They seem to be very, very interested in all things human. It's not just, you know, being physically examined. They are deeply, deeply interested in our emotional makeup. And I do hear all the time, you know, experiencers saying that their memories are being recorded. I talked to one lady, Pat Cates was her name, from Louisiana, and she had an experience where they basically recorded everything in her brain, all her thoughts, all her life experience. She says, you know, I feel like they basically made a carbon copy of me. And that turned out to be her last experience. She says, I guess they don't need me anymore. They've got everything I've had.
Well, maybe they'll come back after she's reloaded with more life.
But yeah, I hear this all the time. In fact, one of the cases in this book, my own sister-in-law, she was visited by the short blue beings. She drew.
Oh, I know them well.
Yeah, she drew an illustration. She drew an illustration of them, and I showed it to other contactees, and like, wow, that's very accurate. And she said the same thing. And mind you, she's just a 9-year-old child when this happens. And they're like, she asked them, what are you doing? They said, we are recording your memories. We are taking your memories. So I think that's one of the things they are harvesting. They are taking. And there is a whole missing time aspect. And I do have talked to a number of contactees. One lady, she's like, I don't really remember my childhood. So there is, I do wonder about that, if they, because they have the ability to erase people's memories of these events, and often will do that.
They do.
Yeah.
My last missing time experience was a few weeks ago, and it was completely clear. There was no question about the fact that it had happened. I've mentioned it on the show before, but for those of you who haven't heard it, I'll very briefly mention it. I was going to have a Zoom meeting at 12:30, and I was looking for something to eat. I glanced at the clock in the kitchen, the one on the microwave oven, because I was concerned about how much time I had. I opened the refrigerator and the power went out, and I thought, oh great, there goes my Zoom meeting. I closed the refrigerator, and a second later, the power went back on. Only it was not 12:02, which it had been a moment ago. It was now 12:24. In other words, during that power failure, I lost 22 minutes of time completely. And guess who was showing up in another couple of hours at the house? Danny Sheehan.
Oh, all right.
Spent the afternoon and evening together. I'm quite certain that it was preparation for the meeting with Danny Sheehan, and they probably watched, and Mark Sims was there too. He's another very high level close encounter witness, and Danny of course is right in the thick of everything, and it was all about what would be said and so forth during that afternoon and evening.
Yeah, and what's interesting to me that you mentioned this is that you were aware of it, because people can have missing time and not know it.
I think we all have a lot of that. I bet you have it.
Yeah, in fact, I was thinking back on that because I've had a sighting once in 1992 where a little ball of light came swooping down in front of my car and darted away. And I always tell people, yeah, that's my sighting, until someone asks, well, what happened after? And I'm like, huh, because I was just left my brother and sister-in-law's house. I should have turned around. You know, that was my first real UFO sighting. I'm like, should have turned around and said, I saw a UFO. You wouldn't believe it. I don't remember what happened. I don't remember driving home. I forgot the whole experience. It was gone from my mind for a number of months until one day it just sort of plopped back in my head. And now I realize, like, this is classic missing time. This is exactly what people have been describing to me for a long time. And even though I knew that, it still slipped away from me. So yeah, I'm pretty darn sure I've had missing time.
Yeah, well, exactly. And I think it's possible, folks, that everybody has missing time. We just don't know it because it's missing time. Yep. You know, it's so fascinating to be involved in this because you're never sure. Are we all involved? And just some of us happen to remember bits and pieces of it? Is the human world actually different from what it seems? Or is this more like what it looks like, that somebody is trying to contact us and wake us up? And they're shaking our cage a lot. I mean, every single close encounter witness has had their cage shaken because you don't expect it. I mean, let's face it, even now, when we know about things like aliens, if someone wakes up and finds staring down at them, it's going to be a big surprise.
Yeah. Well, I think humans are really good at denial. And this is one of the reasons that, you know, they will come down and give you a little scare. Because if they don't, you'll just continue to deny it.
Right.
Or very fear-based, too. I mean, we're taught to fear from a very early age.
Very much so.
It's pumped through the media. It's constant.
Right.
So I think that's one of the reasons this phenomena is perhaps getting an undeserved reputation for being hostile, which I don't think, I'm speaking generally here, I don't think they're here to take over our planet, certainly, or anything really like that. When someone's taken on board a craft, this can be traumatic. This can be very scary. It can sometimes be painful. But generally, that's confined to the physical examination.
Right.
That's the worst I hear. And if someone does not have a strong fear response, it can be a very different experience. It can be quite benevolent and often is. But I do think it's widespread. I noticed this early on. I'm like, well, how come I know so many experiencers? Some of the people I know have been taken on board. How can this be? And I heard a quote from J. Allen Hynek that 1 in 40 people have had this experience. And I thought, no way. That's way too many. And it was, you know, that's what kicked me into high gear. I started asking everyone. I didn't have to ask 40 people. And it was just a couple of years later, 1991, I think, when the Roper organization did a survey on this, and they found 1 in 50. So I think it is widespread. I interviewed a guy in England who's quite sure this is more than that. He was on board a craft and saw a warehouse-sized room filled with people who did not appear to be conscious. And so he's thinking this could be something that's involving way more than just 1 in 40. He thinks perhaps everybody.
When I was a boy, I saw a big room like that filled with soldiers lying on cots in uniform. A whole, like, it could have been a whole company or more of soldiers. And one of the first things that tipped me off to the fact that my childhood experiences were real was that a friend, Mike Ryan, who's sadly enough now passed on, remembered the incident. He told Ed Conroy that I had come home from this trip talking about all these soldiers that I had seen. And it's so eerie because I think that every one of those people was a contactee. every one of the people that it were in that huge room you're talking about, a contactee, and goodness knows how many. And yet, we're not awake even yet. It's so hard. So hard. Preston, we're coming up on another break. And I'd like you to give us an idea of where we can, the best place to find you on the internet is.
Yeah, certainly. Thanks. I do have a website. If you just use a search engine on my name, it should take you right there. It's PrestonDennett.Weebly.com. I'm also on Facebook, of course, and Twitter. And I do have a new, well, relatively new YouTube channel where I'm putting out my research in a way that I think is more accessible to a wider audience.
Yes.
This is an important subject. Right. I think it's going to change the world. I mean, we're seeing it change the world. So
we are indeed. Okay, Free Dreamlanders, kick back, enjoy the commercials, and they're going to be about subscribing to Dreamland and reading books, and so do those things, and you'll help us a lot. We'll be right back.
UnknownCountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe, in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations, but more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future.
We're talking to Preston Dennett, his website, PrestonDennett.Weebly.com. I guess that's with two E's, Weebly.com. You can find him on YouTube and Facebook. His new book, Wondrous, 25 True UFO Encounters. And Preston, I think it's time to kind of dig into some of those encounters. And, you know, military and its situation has been much in the news lately. So I think it would be a good idea if we could start with the Malmstrom Air Force Base encounter with Mel Hansen. That is in your book, chapter 19.
Yeah, I was so delighted to be contacted by this gentleman whose story has not been told before. The Malmstrom incident took place in Montana in 1967. It's quite well known, I think, within the UFO community, certainly. Robert Salas was one of the witnesses to it, and he's written a book on this case, Faded Giant, which talks about how a number of UFOs came down over this missile base. This is where we have nuclear warheads, and basically shut them down. And not just one or two, all of them. And he was underground when this happened. He didn't get to see the UFOs themselves, but he has since located a number of other witnesses and basically was a very important whistleblower bravely, courageously stepped forward and got this incident to the public. And it's an incredible event. And Mel Hansen contacted me. He had actually heard this on TV and thought, oh, okay, I guess it's okay to talk about it. And tried to contact a few other researchers and radio stations and just couldn't seem to get through. Didn't give up. He's quite elderly when I spoke to him, which was 4 years ago, I believe. Five. Yeah. And he's like, I want to do my part. I want to do my part to get disclosure out. And he told an incredible story. He was actually a firsthand eyewitness. He was out in the field right next to one of these missiles when this UFO showed up. And he said it was quite large, totally silent, blocking off the stars, went right over the missile itself and shut it down. He was inside a Jeep and he's radioing to his superiors what he's seeing. And they said, stay in the Jeep, just stay there. He got out, he stepped out and looked at this thing because he wanted to get a closer look. He couldn't believe what he was seeing. Didn't see any little green men or anything like that, he said, but it was clearly not a helicopter or anything. And this missile thing, the whole base there shut down. The electricity went off. And these, of course, do have backup systems. And he went into that quite a bit. He said immediately after it shut down, it went onto diesel power. There's a diesel generator. But just after that turned on, it shut down. And there's a third backup, actually. There's a battery power backup. And so it went back online and then it got shut down again. So it was a triple fail safe. Yeah, a triple fail safe, which failed. I think this is, from a military standpoint, I can see why the people in charge might think this is hostile. Like they're shutting down our missiles. This is not good. They must have been in a complete panic. And they were. I mean, he found out.
Those are our most sensitive. A missile base is probably the most sensitive place that the military has. And, you know, they have a habit of showing up at sensitive places. Jacques Vallée and Paola Harris just published a book, which I interviewed them on Dreamland a couple of weeks ago, Trinity, about a UFO crash that occurred right near the Trinity site where the first atomic bomb was exploded. Then Roswell happens, and that crash takes place 30 miles north of the most sensitive military base in the Western world, where the only atomic bomber wing on Earth is based. And now here they are at missile bases. Yep. They do have a habit of going to our most sensitive military places. You know, underneath the surface, behind the scenes, the military must be very concerned about this.
I bet they're sweating bullets. I get it. You know, I get it. But looking at the Malmstrom incident, they didn't actually take the missiles. They didn't destroy them. They didn't hurt anybody. I think the clear message, like, what are you doing? This is one of the number one messages that contactees are given. And I have to tell you, pretty much every, I don't want to say every, but many of the military officers who contacted me, like one guy, Dr. Gary Wagoner, he was on the USS Long Beach, a guided missile cruiser, nuclear powered. Another guy, Ray Sachs, was an electrician's mate on the USS Clamagore. He had an incredible USO encounter in 1971 as the submarine was on the surface of the ocean on the eastern coast of the US, and a USO paced their submarine for 15 minutes. They carried
underwater. Undersurface unknown object or USO. Yeah.
And the Clamagore was carrying nuclear tipped torpedoes. So this is definitely something they're very, very concerned about. Anything nuclear, they are there. They are watching over it very closely.
I wonder why it's so important, the nuclear stuff. I guess, you know, what would happen if we had a nuclear exchange would be that parts of the planet that were struck by bombs would be made radioactive for eons, not just years, but forever, essentially, because of plutonium and the slow half-life of plutonium and strontium-90.
And I think it goes beyond that, actually.
Go ahead.
Because this is what a number of contactees have been told, that not only is it destroying our planet and destroying us as a species, but it's causing sort of tears into other dimensions. We are damaging areas we're not even aware of. This is causing far-reaching damage. And that's one of the reasons they're so concerned, because we're not only hurting ourselves, we're hurting others who we're not aware of.
I can well believe that. In my book, A New World, I describe a period of time at the Lakota Sioux Reservation in South Dakota, where I was able to see an entirely other version of this world. It was incredible. And it was real. It was there. And is there. And I can easily conceive that of the idea that the power of a nuclear explosion would be so great that it might burst into parallel universes.
Yeah, I worry about it. I wonder about like incidents like the Chernobyl accident, Three Mile Island, more recently Fukushima. Right. Where were they? You know, why didn't they? And I've talked to some contactees who are having contact on a regular basis. I'm like, why didn't they intervene? And basically the answer was, we have to learn by our own mistakes.
Right.
If they were to, you know, prevent every single nuclear accident, and apparently they have intervened in a number of cases, but not always, because we have to learn. And I think we have learned from certainly Hiroshima. That hasn't happened again. You know, we do have to learn some hard lessons. Every parent knows you can't solve your child's problems. They have to go out and learn through the school of hard knocks.
That's also the way the visitors teach. They don't instruct. They let you find out on your own. That's why when I hear people who are getting guidance from them, I often wonder if that isn't their imagination. Because in my experience, when I have learned, it is because, not because I've been told, but because I've been drawn into situations where I could figure it out for myself.
Precisely, yeah.
Yeah, and I'm sure I'm not alone in that in terms of close encounter witnesses. Let's go on. Let's talk about the couple who learned that the aliens had a high level of interest in their child.
Yes, this was a case that really tugged at my heartstrings. This young couple living in Canada, they had recently moved there. The gentleman's wife was from Europe. English was their second language. They were having a lot of red tape issues with their citizenship and just moving to a new home. He was starting a business, finding a job. They had a lot of stuff going on when they became pregnant. This was kind of an unplanned pregnancy, but they were certainly happy about it. And this was 2006. And this pregnancy proceeded normally all the way up to about 7 months, I think she was pregnant, when they had a very strange incident. They were driving over to a friend's house for a party when they became disoriented, lost track of where they were. And the next thing they knew, they were at the party far too early. They had arrived at their destination much more quickly than they should have.
My God.
So that was sort of an unusual missing time incident, because often people will be late an hour.
Yes.
But perhaps
not early.
Right? So perhaps they were picked up and dropped off much closer in an attempt to sort of hide the missing time aspect. And they didn't quite pick up on what was going on here. All they knew was there was a confusion of time and place. I found out after questioning them, they both do have a history of UFO encounters. Not only them, their parents. The husband had seen UFOs, so had his father. The woman, her dad was a prominent psychical investigator in Europe, and she was somewhat regularly visited by what she called light beings. She would see these glowing figures in her room. But this was something that they didn't, you know, talk much about. They weren't religious, but they were very spiritual, is how they described themselves. Her more so, he was more rational. But at any rate, this pregnancy proceeded normally. They went to the doctor, verified the pregnancy. They had a midwife. They heard the baby's heartbeat at like 3 months, I think it was. 4 months, the baby started kicking, and she grew a big belly. Her breasts increased in size. She sent me a picture, actually, of her pregnant. She sent me her doctor's reports verifying the pregnancy. So this was well verified. This wasn't, you know, a hysterical pregnancy, as some doctors might try to call, because of what happened next. And this is very unusual. I have heard of cases of missing pregnancies involved with this UFO phenomena, but at 7.5 months along in this pregnancy, they woke up one evening because there was an electrical storm right over their house. And it was a tremendous storm. He jumped up to close the window because the lightning was ferocious. I mean, it was crashing down all around them. He looked out the window and a bolt of lightning went sideways right through his backyard. They thought that was unusual. This is not normal lightning. No. So they're like, what is going on? He slammed the window closed and jumped back into bed. And they were huddling together, a little bit frightened. Next thing they know, they're waking up the next morning. Like, that's weird. How did we fall asleep so fast? Because they were, you know, had adrenaline pumping through their bloodstream. And she immediately wakes up and says, honey, I don't feel pregnant. And he's like, what are you talking?
No.
Yeah. He's like, what are you talking about? Just look at my belly. Does it look smaller? And he's like, yeah, it does, a little bit. At that time, the baby was in a breech position and that she was doing exercises to sort of encourage the baby to turn around. And they thought, perhaps that's it. They had an appointment for the doctor in 3 days. They moved it up, moved it forward to, I believe it was that day they went. And they go to the doctor, and the doctor's really concerned. And he keeps checking and keeps checking. He's like, well, I can't find a heartbeat. You know, I have to tell you, I don't know what happened here. It's going to be disciplinary action taken, but we apparently have made a mistake. You're not pregnant. We think it was a misdiagnosis. And they were like, what? Misdiagnosis? We're 7.5 months along. How can this be a misdiagnosis? They knew it wasn't.
Yes.
Because they felt the baby kicking. They heard the heartbeat many times. And the doctor was like, well, did you, you know, perhaps you had a spontaneous abortion. This does happen. Did you pass any tissue? She says, absolutely not. I sure didn't. So the doctors were absolutely baffled. And this was a time when they were having a lot of trouble, you know, getting medical attention. Not anymore. Doctors were ready to examine them at any time should anything unusual happen. They were moved to the front of the line. They thought that was unusual.
Yes.
But this was, of course, you know, a huge shock. They wept. You know, they were quite upset initially.
Of course, they were devastated, I'm sure.
Yeah, they had built a nursery, you know, painted the walls, got a crib, told their entire family. Both sets of their parents were still alive. And now this baby was gone. And the husband was actually more upset. The wife, she told me, and this was amazing to me. She says, you know, I'm actually kind of okay with this. I'm like, really? She says, yeah, you know, it was hard at first, but I just know my baby is alive. I know it. I know my baby is in good hands. And she got over it pretty quickly.
That's amazing.
Yeah, they had a hard time telling their parents, let me tell you.
So many people have lost women eggs and men semen. I've had semen taken from me. And I've often wondered what happened and where the, if there's a baby or there are other, there are children or where they are. I've seen some people from time to time under very strange circumstances who seem to be working with the visitors. Do you have any reports of that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
there are a little bit about it, because I have a feeling they may have, human, they may take people in every once in a while, and so that they can work with them from their side of the fence.
Absolutely. Yeah, there's a lady I'm working with right now. You actually spoke with her. Dolly says hi, by the way.
Oh, sure.
If you remember her, she was a chapter in one of my, in my book, Onboard UFO Encounters.
Uh-huh.
And
yes, I remember very well. I believe we did a Dreamland together.
Exactly, yeah. Yes. And her case was far, far more extensive than she let on initially, which is something I deal with a lot of experiencers. They're very reluctant to tell the whole story because it's embarrassing, perhaps, or it's difficult for them to deal with. They've dealt with a lot of ridicule and trust issues.
There's internal restraint too. There's an unwilling, there's something, I think there's something planted in people's minds to keep them quiet.
Yeah, they're told don't talk flat out. But yeah. At some point the ETs will say, it's time for you to talk. We want you to talk. And she's at that stage. And she has regular contact and does deal with abductees. She's often, this is one of her jobs, so to speak, mm-hmm. is to help people who are gathered and have to go through a physical examination, which can be, no one really likes going to the doctor or, you know, having a root canal, or which we know is for our own benefit. And it's her job to sort of soothe people, let them know what's going on. And I've heard this from a number of contactees, that this is their job, is to sort of facilitate. They don't like the word abduction. These are people who've moved far along in their understanding of what's going on here. And they don't feel like it's hostile. They don't feel like this is a negative experience, and that there are actually very important, very good reasons for people being taken on board. And it's her job, their job, to sort of facilitate this and help the grays who, you know, don't have some difficulties communicating with people, certainly not as good as the average human can.
Yes.
So I think that's what's going on here.
I think there may be people in the excuse me, I've got eye allergies, folks. It's nothing unusual for people who watch this show frequently. I am Mr. Allergy. There may be people who lead two lives without even realizing it. I'm going to take you back to a story. I was giving a speech. Oh, this was back long ago, probably in the late 90s. And there was a little boy. It was a big audience with all kinds of people in it. And in the middle of the audience, there was one little boy who looked about 7 or 8. And I thought, how interesting that someone would bring a little child to this. And I'm talking, and this is no ordinary little boy, because he's listening carefully. Afterwards, I'm walking out, and he and his parents walk up, and they want to talk to me. And the little boy is the one who wants to talk. And he says to me, I am a helper. I help people who go on the ships. And I just want you to know that I've helped you.
Wow. Wow.
It's so extraordinary. So incredible. And then right here in this apartment, I once had an experience where I was awakened, and it was obvious that there was something physical unfolding. And what looked like the little girl walked into my bedroom. Like about a 10 or 11 year old, perfectly normal looking kid. But the problem was, it was 2 o'clock in the morning and the doors were locked. And so I said, I said something like, well, you're a little girl. And she looked at me and said, no, I'm not. And that's all I remember.
Wow.
So isn't it an extraordinary thing? I, if nothing else, it certainly makes life interesting, doesn't it?
It sure does.
Preston, hold on a minute. We have a little break to take. I'm struggling a little bit because my stopwatch broke and I'm keeping time on my phone. That's why I keep looking down. And anyway, we have a little break. We're talking to Preston Dennett. His wondrous new book is called Wondrous, 25 UFO Encounters Stories, and they're wonderfully, wonderfully told. You can get in touch with Preston at prestondennett.weebly.com, and you can find him on YouTube, and you can find him on Facebook. Preston gets around, and if you have a UFO story you'd like to tell and get help from a real, really good investigator, Preston's your man. We'll be right back.
There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is, if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle.
We're talking to Preston Dennett. His book, Wondrous, 25 True UFO Encounters. And they are wondrous. That's accurate, Preston. And so why don't you pick one that is wondrous to you, particularly.
Yeah, sure. Hey, I appreciate that. That is the thing, I think, the thread that really ties all these accounts together, because people have a lot of different experiences. Some feel, react differently, but the sense of wonder is something all of them describe. And one of the cases that really struck me, and boy, this mother and son duo of all the cases in this book just really affected me emotionally. I mean, I wept along with them when they described what happened. This is a mother from Indiana who has a young teenage son. And he was 14 years old when they went to the dentist for his annual checkup, and put him in the dentist chair, got a cleaning, examination, and then x-rays. And after they took the x-rays, all the other dentists started coming in, all the other dental assistants, and they were crowding around the x-rays. And his mother is watching through the view window at what's going on, and she's kind of signals to her son, what's happening? What's taking so long? He kind of shrugs and says, I don't know. Finally, the main dentist kind of signals to her, like, come on in, opens the door, we need you to come in. And she's getting worried. She's like, oh no, something's wrong with my son. And they take her to the x-rays and says, what's this? And I actually
asked her, what is
it? Yeah.
Yeah.
I included these x-rays in the book. They showed her these x-rays, and there is what looks like a marble under the child's back molar, the lower molar in his mouth, in his jaw. and maybe smaller than a marble, but certainly larger than a BB. And they said, well, what is this? Did your son get shot in the mouth with a BB gun? And they're looking at him and looking at her. And they both said, well, no, that never happened. We would have remembered that. No. And they said, well, what is it? And she joked, well, maybe it's an alien implant. Joking. Nobody laughed.
Nobody laughed.
No. And they were just totally deadpan about it. And she's like, oh my God, I was just joking. She had no history of UFO encounters. And neither did her son. Or so he said initially. She's like, I need a copy of that x-ray. You know, I need to see this. What's going on here? And they were given to her. She found out that this was actually there on their previous visit, but the prior dentist covered it up, did not say. So this upset her. She's still trying to get those first x-rays. And she went home and she started doing research because she wanted to find out what's going on here. And the idea of aliens was the farthest thing from her mind. She did not want to go there. But there was no other explanation. And finally, she's looking stuff up on the internet, thinks, well, gosh, you know, could this be something to do with UFOs? She started to feel how she described it was like a Richard Dreyfuss in Close Encounters building mashed potatoes on his plate. She could not let this go and needed some help, and finally found me, sent me the x-rays, which I, you know, asked permission if I could share these with some medical professionals, which I did. I sent them to two doctors. One's an emergency physician, one's a general physician. And they both immediately said the same thing. Did he get shot in the mouth with a BB gun? And I said, no. They have no history of that. And look, there's no entry wound. The tissues are fine. There's no foreign body reaction. There's no pain involved with this. His tooth is fine. It shouldn't be. If you see these x-rays, this thing is rather large. And I pointed out, it's actually kind of bigger than a BB. And they said, well, it's clearly metallic and it's clearly artificial. We would diagnose it as a foreign body. Do they have any history of encounters? And this is when I really started to dig into that. And she denied it at first. Later she says, well, I do have this weird peculiarity in my sinuses. It's always been there. I have a couple of weird marks on my body. I've had some weird alien dreams. And I'm like, well, what about your son? She's like, no, he hasn't seen anything. I'm like, well, did you ask him? And I was on the phone with her. He did not want to speak to me directly. He was, you know, 14, 15 years old at this time. But I could hear him in the background. And she said, have you ever seen a UFO? And he's like, well, Mom, yeah, I did. I didn't want to tell you. And this was immediately prior to this being found on the x-rays. He was out with his best friend walking outside their home when a UFO, for lack of a better word, came swooping down. It was quite high up at first, came swooping down and started flashing colored lights at them. It was totally silent, clearly not a plane. They both felt it was observing them, and they became alarmed and ran off. They don't have any clear memory of missing time, but I continued to question him through her. And he does have ET dreams. He's very much entranced by what we would call the human-looking ETs. I don't like the term Nordic because I don't think that's accurate. They're not just Nordic. They are all different races, the human-looking ETs.
There are, yeah. And there could be people, as we talked about earlier, who are human and who were raised among them.
Absolutely. I have cases of this. A gentleman from England.
Well, we're just about to finish the first hour, and so we'll talk about some of those cases in the last half hour. But go ahead and let's conclude this one.
So what's really interesting about this case is I got it while it was ongoing. This was a current case. Often it takes years for people to come to grips with what's going on. But she had physical evidence. So I was in communication with her as this case unfolded. And she calls me up. I think it was a year later. Like, you're not going to believe it. They came. I'm like, who came? She says, the Grays. And they came with an answer. They came to tell her what's going on. It's basically what happened. Her son, you know, has a lot of trouble sleeping sometimes. And sleeps with the nightlight and so on. And she says, Mom, I can't sleep. And so he came to sleep in her bedroom. And that's when the Grays came. And she woke up unable to move, had to force her eyes open, and was shocked to see Grays hovering over her son. And she looked towards the doorway, and there was a Gray looking right at her. They locked gazes. She says it was just higher than the doorknob, quite short.
Yes.
And they said, it's okay. Everything's okay. You don't need to worry. It's fine. It's fine. It's fine. It's fine. It's fine. Over and over and over again. And she eventually fell back asleep and woke up the next morning feeling a weight off of her shoulders. Turns to her son and says, guess who came? He's like, what are you talking about? She says, it might be a dream. You know, this could be a dream. She wanted to give him that out. Didn't want to alarm him. She says, I think it was the Grays. ETs came. And he said, for you? And she said, no, honey, for you. And he's like, oh, I wonder if my implant is still there. And they did go to the dentist again, and it was still there. They took a second x-ray. The implant was gone. 30 seconds later, gone.
Oh, my God.
And
incredible.
They took another x-ray. It was there again.
There again? There and back?
Yep. They can do this. And I'm not sure what is going on here. This is reported in other cases.
I had a case with Roger Lear like that, sort of like that, where an implant was sending out an FM radio signal in the guy's neck when it was in his neck, and it was taken out, and Roger brought it to Southwest Research, and it was nickel iron. We looked at it under the scanning electron microscope, but when we put it under X-ray diffraction, it immediately was it wasn't visible to X-rays. And of course, we put it under X-ray diffraction because we figured there must be some technology of some kind in it, or it wouldn't have been emitting a radio signal.
Yeah.
We weren't allowed to see that technology.
They can move it in and out of a person's body. And what's really interesting about this case is the son. I'm like asking about him. He's profoundly psychic, daily, has clairvoyance, precognition. He's super sensitive. I think he's got a strong mission coming up in this world, because that's what I see. People who are having contact are people who are doing good work for humanity. These are social workers.
I see that too. I see that too.
Absolutely a pattern. They're social workers.
It's your life and it's my life. I mean, all the people in our area are doing this, and most of us have had contact.
Yep. Yep,
yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely a pattern. And she had another visitation not long after where she was taken on board. She said, Preston, the interior of this craft was dressed up to be a living room. There was a couch. There was a TV.
God. Never say the Grays don't have a sense of humor.
Yeah, they do this. She's like, she says, you're not going to believe me. I'm like, try me. Because I've heard this before. She says, in walked a praying mantis, 9 feet tall. And did a little...
you're in the living room. Oh, it's actually, this is going to be fine. And then here comes the 9 foot tall praying mantis.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
There was another gentleman in there. And they were just talking shop. You know, like, what are you doing here? And like, oh, yeah, they're in contact with me. They were very calm and relaxed. And then this praying mantis walks in and starts putting this device on the back of the gentleman's neck, and then walks to her, and she stands up and says, no, 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 no. And that's all she really remembers.
All she really remembers. Okay. Free Dreamlanders, we have come to the end of your time with us. And every week we ask the same thing. And every week, most of you do not. So I'm not going to ask this week. We've been talking to Preston Dennett. His website is prestondennett.weebly.com. His new book is called Wondrous for a reason. 25 true UFO encounters, and it's a marvelous achievement. They are truly wondrous encounters. You can also find Preston on Facebook and YouTube. Subscribers, we're just going to keep right on keeping on.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.